The following content is provided by MIT OpenCourseWare under a Creative Commons license. Additional information about our license and MIT OpenCourseWare in general is available at ocw.mit.edu.
Thanks. You see, and then you know, no matter what the tool you're using is, you've got to look closely at the tool marks to get a sense of what's going on, right? All the time.
A little bit fuller like, back, you know, in here. Like, so you may not want to take off for today. I think that this model is going to be used for a demonstration today too, of how to redevelop design when you're drafting.
If
you could get a couple of curves, maybe the transom.
Whereas, you know, with this thing,
I would get maybe one back here somewhere.
Okay.
Maybe this shape back here, and then
Should I try to make 7 things?
Yeah.
No. I think just go ahead and draw it now, because you can always erase it.
I would say go ahead and make it
literal for now. And the other thing that you want to do, just do that part now. And then we'll add water lines to yours later on. Another arbitrary water line, or center line, rather. I'm going to mention that to Tony, because that could be confusing right there. The square?
Not the square, the triangle, right triangle.
The big plastic ones? Yeah, that there's a cardboard.
Yeah, and the piece of, I mean, this piece of film is probably an angle of whatever it's going to do. I think it'd be smart too, because a lot of times, you don't have a cardboard.
When you're working in drawing, I don't know if you've done any computer drawing of any sort. You have. You know how you work in layers and that all came from what people can do with paper, which is that when you get something to a certain extent, then you just layer another sheet on top and pick up the stuff through it and then continue to develop things from there. Basically, you've got this one line left to draw, right? To capture what the model has, and then at that point, what we're going to do is going to lay another. Ruben's going to see if he can get some tracing paper. Lay a sheet of tracing paper or another sheet of this would be good enough to pick up the lines through it, and then I'm going to go over with you how to start developing this further.
Thank you.
10 inches of water.
Okay.
Everything being a kickup. You wouldn't have as good a steering or anything like that, but you could do it without hurting the boat. So on that, if that's a principle that makes sense to you, and I think it might for your use, I would make that quite that keel just barely proud of the line along here. Does that make sense?
I think so. Yeah, no, I kind of like that idea.
Okay. Cool. Okay. Yeah. So we out here have this part be a quarter of an inch. About a 45-minute to an hour-long lecture workshop part of the day. So Tony's going to take the lead on that, obviously, to talk about designing and reiterating the design on the drafting board. And then following that, we'll kind of go back to as we are, some drawing, some finishing. We'll have different kinds of drawings going on through the day. And I'm also going to go after lunch. So Tony has his one-on-one time with all you guys. So let's all pick a table and a drafting board. Raphael's board is over here, Tony.
Yeah.
You know. Oh, and just so you know, Tony, because all of the lines get lifted in the same plane, all the section lines.
Yeah. Yeah.
There kind of has to be two center lines. You can't really roll them over and have them.
Okay.
You know, half on one side, stern half on the
all
other.
Right.
So that's why there's two lines here.
Okay.
So
all right. Okay, so why didn't everybody come on over?
I can go get Tracy.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, good idea. Okay, so on Monday, we roughed out the basic starting master lines for each of these designs that set up the rough parameters of the kind of characteristics of each of the boats. And based on our brief analysis of what each boat was going to be intended for, we made a first attempt at, well, what would be the best characteristics for that boat, and laid out those starting lines, and then you spent the last couple of days, carving these blocks in a way that was intended to reconcile those lines, those starting lines, master lines, to each other, in a way over this three-dimensional volume, because. Obviously, each one of those lines was started as a two-dimensional line projected in space, and then by carving, you eliminated everything that was outside of those lines, and you're also using the tools to help add information in between the lines that we'd set up, so that it was like, well, what's going to happen between this area and this area? Well, the tool is going to show me what's going to happen between there by using the tool more or less to your advantage. You more or less quickly were able to flesh out the whole surface, starting from that wire framework of those original lines, projections. Now, when we go to paper, in a sense, we're recapitulating that whole process, but we're going to do it in a more abstract manner. You know, here you're not having to conceptualize, visualize in your mind the three-dimensional volume, because you're actually creating a three-dimensional volume. But on the other hand, you've got the resistance of three-dimensional mass, you know, and you've, you know, had to use actual cutting tools to force your will on this lump of reality. When we go to paper, we kind of etherealize all of those problems, because now you're not having to physically carve away anything. You're just drawing, you know, abstractly drawing lines, you know, on a sheet of paper. The hardest thing to do is to erase a little bit of carbon, or to draw another little bit of carbon physically. But the challenge here becomes greater in that now, with the experience of the model and the actual model sitting next to you, you're going to have to learn to start to visualize how these lines on a piece of paper represent that three-dimensional space, you know, three-dimensional form that you've been struggling to create in reality. And when you get to the point when you can successfully do that, then you actually are liberated to a large extent from having to deal with the design physically, because you can deal with it abstractly in this way. It also opens up the possibility to take accurate measurements, because you saw how that's can be quite accurate to take lines off of, you know, those dimensions off the model, but that still, especially at these scales, you can discern barely a sliver of misaligned line on a piece of paper, which is a much higher accuracy than you could with a tool like that, or even, you know, with some sort of a laser gizmo to do it off of a physical model. So because of that gain in accuracy and the ease of picking up quantitative information off of the drawing, that opens up the possibility to do mathematical analyses of the design, and then which allows you to hook into a body of experience built up over the last couple hundred years of how these different formulas and these different derivatives, how those might compare to actual performance in reality. So as you get more abstract, you also open up the possibility to turn this into a more of a scientific study, as opposed to just you and your intuition and the, you know, the carved model. And it's one of the reasons why a designer working this way can have felt more comfortable doing a broader range of designs than the craftsman builder designer would have done, who was only had the experience with these models. And while kind of doing this timeline, we'll just take it all the way to the end right now. The next evolution of all of this, of course, has been computer design. And I mentioned that briefly on Monday. In computer design, you actually end up kind of reconciling both of these working methods and folding them into each other, so that you're creating a virtual model just that is virtually as three-dimensional as these models are, but you've abstracted the actual cutting. You're no longer cutting mass. You're just manipulating algorithms to create this virtual illusion of a three-dimensional mass. And then, because of the fact that the programs allow you to do all sorts of mathematical analysis on that virtual 3D mass, and greatly automates all of that, it allows you to do everything that you could have done on to analyze a paper drawing, just within the you know, within the virtual 3D world. So that you know, as you'll find out when we go from 3D to paper, there's a lot of the immediacy that gets lost, and that's, you know, part, a lot of what you guys have got to try to tune yourselves into is to find the nuances to kind of try to capture it back. But still, for instance, the way in which a shear line interacts in 3D at different angles and from different directions and at different distances, which has a lot to do with what the character of the boat is going to be, are really very hard to judge just off of some flat views on a piece of paper. Once you get back into virtual model world, though, of course, all of that is readily available again, because you can just twist and turn and change viewpoint and look at that model from any angle. So so again, you're reconciling the immediacy. And then the other big advance is, in my opinion, has been that with the physical model, it took, you know, a lifetime of experience with a narrow type, or even generations of experience with a narrow type of boat, to gain a body of experience that could then be tied in to some sort of nuances within the model that the designer builder could be confident enough would actually get an improvement in desired result from one boat to the next. It was a very slow, methodical, step-by-step evolution of design from one boat to the next to the next. When you're able to jump to the analysis that can be done on a paper drawing, and that being able to plug into a wider and deeper base of experiential knowledge through those analyses, you sped up that process of gaining an intuitive grasp of the medium, of what you were working with, and being able to then make judgments by looking at the lines that you could feel would carry a certain conviction that yes, making this change is going to have this particular result in the end. Now, I started designing on paper, and you know, for the first 10 years or more, worked exclusively on paper and on physical models. That's one of my models right there. That was done from a design that was originally done on paper, and actually I lofted and built the boat before this model was built. But then after, you know, then the PC, you know, personal computers came around, and I made a transition from designing that way to designing in CAD. And it was, you know, a very steep learning curve for a long time, because, you know, when you're really the first generation to be on the other side of that divide. But before virtual reality existed, the only way that you could interact with creating, you know, volume in space was either physically with a model or a sculpture or whatever, by carving or molding, or abstractly on paper, and those required a physical interaction with the object, or a physical interaction with the representation on paper. But then when you go into working in virtual reality, it's kind of like the old those nuclear experiments where you're working with through the rubber gloves or with the little robotic arms, and you're behind the glass and you're trying to make something happen on the other side of the glass, and all the tools you have are a keyboard and a mouse. Very different from you know, grabbing this rasp and doing this, but in effect, once you've learned what you're doing, the algorithm in the computer program is doing exactly the same thing as, you know, when you ask it to do this same process, it's doing exactly the same thing, but it's doing it, using this other tool and this other medium. So anyway, so there's this big long transition to being able to understand and work with these mediums, then to go and work behind the glass box. But what I found once I started to get fluent in that was that because of the facility involved, both in creating the forms and also in analyzing the forms, that what happened was a quantum jump, really. You know, the evolution from this to this maybe gained a broadness of experience that was three times, let's say. But I found that the jump from this stuff to CAD allowed for a jump in experience of maybe 10 or 50 or 100 to 1. In that to analyze, to draw and analyze a design, a model on paper, and then with measuring tools and then with the equations, it takes about a week per iteration, or took me about a week per iteration to work on. And iteration, of course, means basically when you guys are done with everything this week, you'll have done an iteration, which means you'll have taken a basic conception and you'll have taken it through to the point where you have something down on paper that covers the whole, that is an attempt at the whole model. Then that plus the basic computations and basic analysis of the design would take me about a week to do. And of course, you're never going to get a design right in the first iteration, and that's just not at all the way things work. I mean, even if whatever you did in the first iteration, you'd certainly want to iterate a few times just to settle it in. And so basically about four iterations is a month. And over a career of designing that way, and even with the kind of shortcuts of having a whole office of people drawing for you, and having a bunch of designs being very derivative of other designs, so that their changes are fairly minor, which you would have found in a design office 50 years ago or 75 years ago. Still, in a lifetime, you might do a few hundred designs. And I found that in a year in CAD, I was able to do hundreds of iterations in a year. And either for, for finally, a lot of those would be finally tuning a type from one generation to the next and making very evolutionary changes, and others would be running parallel, like basically all of the different types of boats that we're doing now. Instead of having nine people do them, I basically would have, let's say, nine of these types moving along, and I was able to move those types ahead. It's the old cut and paste. I mean, nothing is ever lost. You just take another iteration and move it ahead, and you haven't lost what you did before. You guys know all that very well. Obviously, you grew up with it. What I found is that what that allowed for was that it took something that before happened at such a slow pace that it was hard over a human lifetime to actually get an intuitive grasp over what the modulations might be. You kind of would hint out. It's like trying to create a prediction graph or something where you only have a few scattered clouds of points. That very slowly accumulate. It's like, well, how do I get a trend out of all of this when there's so few points and they're so scattered over a long period of time? But when you compress all of that into a short period of time, I found it was kind of analogous to saying, to sit someone out in a pasture in front of a sapling and say, all right, now I want you to sit here in front of this tree, and then I want you to understand how this tree grows. That's not that easy a job. But if you took a film of that of a time lapse of a tree growing, and then showed it to someone in 15 minutes and compressed 30 years of growth into a 15 minutes or half hour, anyone watching that compressed bit of time like that would gain an intuitive grasp of how it is that a tree grows because of the compression of time. I mean, if you think about that, that applies pretty much to anything in life. You know, things that you're able to experience many, many iterations because they happen quickly, you can take in and absorb a lot easier than things that happen, you know, very slowly and that you don't get much information on. So by experiencing CAD that way and having that much accelerated feedback loop, it brings things that before were either groped at very slowly in a very, you know, through the clouds and very narrowly with, you know, with the craftsman builder designer tradition, or that were approached with the abstract crutches of paper drawing and a certain amount of empirical experience kind of distilled into a few graphs and formulas and sped that up to the point where you could just absorb it and then all of a sudden it opens up it by speeding up experience like that it gains you the ability to kind of to see what would have been very difficult to see before, what it took genius designers to do, you know, 100 years ago, is now much more accessible because you know we don't need to have that incredibly keen ability to analyze. I kind of stress all this because I think that that this is something that I other than what I when I rant about it, I never really hear about this from in any other forums, and I think it's. I think it's a really critical lesson of what computer work allows one to do that's revolutionary that really wasn't available before, and I think that it's a way to that opens up a set of very powerful tools to society to be used in a number of ways, even today, I mean, most people who go into engineering because they had an aptitude for mathematics, which goes back to an aptitude in arithmetic or whatever, and that there's been a real divide in education between those who do math and those who do humanities or who don't think in that or aren't fluent in that kind of numerical analysis. Well, with what computers have done for us now, and just specifically in this field, the computer does all the math, so that the person doing the work doesn't have to necessarily have that same fluency and acuity with numbers. Just like the person flying an airplane doesn't have to have feathers. and know how to fly because they grew up as a bird. I mean, we can let the tool take care of that foundation and then work on top of that, and be a way to bring variety of skills and experiences together into something which before had been categorized and separated into. Into divides. Okay, so come back down to earth. Let's start with just capitulate again, or recapitulate how we're going to recapitulate the design in going from the model to the paper. So we started the model by deciding on a length, a depth of hull, both below the water and roughly above the water, and then a beam, the breadth of the hull, and then some sense of the character of the midsection and of the ends. Now, then you all carved, and then you measured the profiles and the deck plan and the and a certain number of sections using the infernal machine over there, and then you either have or will begin to put those things on paper, and then what we're going to do is start dealing with these the same way we did with the model, and we're going to do them again, but we're going to take advantage of the things that are more direct and easier about working on paper, and then we're going to have the crutch of being able to use the model to help us visualize both what we're keeping from the model and also what we're changing from the model, and again we'll start with the master lines, which again we've the first draft of which we've taken from the model, and then we'll be developing them the same way and how we started with thinking about a midsection and the ends, and then we started thinking, well, how about if we divided it like so, because you know these are also important, and then as we go along, we're going to instead of using the tools kind of to bridge all of these gaps, and also because we need a lot of points to work on the analysis part of it, we're going to then create a whole grid of cross sections, so that we really capture this three-dimensional volume in some detail on the model. And then once we have a first draft of that, which, you know, there's a whole set of crafts and of physical techniques that are required to do this well that you're certainly not going to learn in a few hours. But anyone, no matter what their skill level, would still at that point take that first draft, cover it over with another layer of transparency, and then using this as a foundation. You see, again, this kind of parallels the development that takes us to CAD. When you're carving on the model and you make a mistake, it's kind of fatal. You can always come back and glue a chunk on or whatever, but still, it's very difficult to recover from an error in the model. Whereas here, you've got the eraser, and then you always have another clean sheet of paper. It's a lot easier to recover from an error and to move ahead, and also to hold on to what you had before. You know, the whole cut and paste or save as thing really came from working on paper this way. All right, when you get this to the point where you feel like you've gone as far as you can go comfortably, save as, start another sheet. You make your experiments on that next sheet. You take that to the point where you start to think, well, I might be starting to ruin this. Save as, put another sheet, and you work up in that way, which is something that you couldn't really do in the model, because the model, you know, other than corrective surgery or whatever, it's a start over. It's not a save as. And then at a certain point, we'll get to the point where we'll call it a day, and then start. We'll go over. This will probably be tomorrow morning or midday. We'll start to go over. Actually, the process of measuring and some of the basic analysis of one or two of these boats, and then during this whole process, what I'd like to do is we'll start kind of going over the shoulder and starting with one of these sets of drawings that are already begun. And kind of actually show you how this thing goes, and then since we only have the four boards, and people are at different stages, people will elect or be elected to go right to paper now, and others can continue to work on their models, and we'll just sort of flow along here and see how far we can go. And a lot of points we're going to interrupt and kind of look at a particular thing Again, it's much better to talk about some of the details when specifically relating to a particular example instead of just sort of randomly throwing up a bunch of disjointed facts.
It's important that everybody kind of stay involved in all of the processes. So keep moving around the room to look at what's going on everywhere.
Yeah. Well, I won't be shy to call people over when I think that there's something worth sharing. I'd say that's about it for the pep talk part, I think for for starts, I'd like to start with Luke's drawing. It's the simplest boat to capture on paper, but it probably will, that, for that very reason, it's further along, and also that reason, I think it'd be the easiest one to kind of start getting a grasp of what the process is. So if we can move over here. So I'd like everybody to kind of get in here as close as possible. You don't have to be right side up on the drawing, but close enough to really see what's going on. Okay, so Luke's boat is one of the simplest types of boat, in that it's basically the half hull basically two flat surfaces that are, you know, then flat sheets that are curved and joined at a single angle, and then the whole thing is chopped off at the two ends, and then there, you know, there's a shear, which in many, well, boats of this shape range from anything down from, you know, the little Johnny boats that you know, the aluminum Johnny boats that are for sale at hardware stores, all the way up to 100-foot scow schooners and lighters and different, you know, carrying heavy capacity coastal carrying vessels that were used up until, you know, the early part of the 20th century for carrying things like stone or garbage or, well, you know, the scow actually still exists as a towed barge, you know, that are used now.
And leave Tony.
But this particular one is
Chris will be around.
One of these small little actually, the model, the way it turned out, it's probably not just a little rowing scow, but could even be a little sailing scow too. And so basically the curves that define this boat are the shear, the chine, the profile, which is all of this, and the two transoms, the bow transom and the stern transom. And then so the drawing here, you know, this is called a three view projection, right, where we have it's the other side, but we have a plan view, we have a profile view, and we have sectional views, right? Is everyone able to capture that basic thing that we're cutting this or, you know, or projecting it from these three basic views? And just like the way we started physically with the model, you know, we start with, well, you know, the overall length, the water line, and then, well, how deep is it going to be? How high is it going to be? How much shear is there going to be? How much rocker? That's the curvature or straightness of it here. How beamy is it going to be? And then once we've made these basic decisions of, okay, well, maximum beam is this, and maximum depth is that, and maximum length is that, it's like, all right, well, how do those flesh out? How are they, you know, how do those original stabs at it add up? And in the model, you've used the tools to reconcile all of those points. You know, use reconcile is it's a technical term. Okay, that means that when this model was a rectangular block, it was very much like these projections, right? You weren't physically at this point. You were either up here at this point, or you were, you know, down here at this point. But either of those lines, those two lines weren't necessarily going to come out to any particular spot once you brought them together, you know, in the projection. Is that clear, everybody? You know, that the when this beam here was flat out here, and this height here was way out here, those two projections had not been reconciled with each other. And that by carving away, you said, all right, well, those two hypothetical points, when they intersect and when they relate to all the other hypothetical points, they're going to create a physical edge, a physical corner. And some of them are going to have to compromise, because they have to absolutely have to come out, have to reconcile, and then the result of those two starting points is going to be an actual curve in three-dimensional space.
Can I jump in on that?
Yeah.
Point?
Yeah.
One of the ways that you would exactly that idea. One of the ways you'd use this to build a boat from, say, out of plywood, is you would project this shape as if it was a two-dimensional flat sheet, right? And if you cut out that shape and did the same thing with this end, is when you put them together, they could only meet and touch. If you touch these edges, they could only meet and make this shape, right? It's the only way it could work out. So that's just a way that, I don't know if you said that. But,
yeah, well, just, yeah, that's, I think taking this, I'm not sure if you guys understand what he meant by projecting this into a flat sheet. These shapes can come out of a flat sheet, but if you just took this drawing and he hasn't put this chine on the bottom, this chine on here yet, but if you just took and cut a piece of cardboard or steel or plywood to the shape of this and tried to build this, you wouldn't have it. And the reason being, of course, that that's just a straight projection. It doesn't take into account the fact that this is curved, and that if you took this shape and flattened it out, right, it's actually going to be longer than the projection. Is that clear?
I'm
obvious.
Good. I only have a second.
So, but all of those things are ways, working inward and then back out again, dealing with this projected geometry of the model. So, so now, with more or less skill and accuracy and ease, you all have taken those original ideas and more or less gotten to the point where you're at a recognizable shape, and due to constraints of time and the point of the course, we're gonna continue as though they were all taken as far as they could be, and so then we're now and it wouldn't matter whether or not this model to everyone's eye in this room looked absolutely perfect or not. It still would never be at a, it's still never as developed as it could be. So even if this model had no known faults or whatever, doing this would actually expose things that weren't readily apparent here. So ultimately we'd still be doing this anyway, whether it was a month from now or a year from now, continuing to work on the model. So, now, what you've done is taken the sections off the model using this machine over here, and I'm sure everyone understands how that works, right? And Ruben, I think if anyone else wants to have their lines taken off, they should do that while you're still here, or at least start it while you're still here.
Well, yeah, I think we've done it as a crew, so
you have
And it's definitely a two-man operation.
Okay.
So I think if you just work together,
yeah.
I don't want you to take off shapes until you're really ready with your model.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Okay.
It's
so
not that infernal, Tony.
So now we need to kind of get into some of the All right. Now I've found myself again here. So so now that you've created a reconciled line. When we transfer it onto paper, or if we continue to carve, we would now say, well, we have a line that's true, but is this the true line that we want, right? And we'd adjust it. And of course, on the model, basically the only way you're going to adjust it is by removing more. So the model is going to get smaller and smaller and smaller. But by jumping to paper here, we don't have to, we can kind of equally treat the errors of of things being overly oversized or things being undersized, and treat them all equally without any of the bias of the model, which the model is saying, well, it's a lot easier to take away than it is to add, so I'll just keep on taking away. On the paper now, all of those things are equal. So once we get these datum points onto the page, this is something I mentioned on Monday. You know, when before CAD, every attempt at working on a scale model of anything was always an attempt. You always had to hold on to the idea that accuracy was a hard-won battle, and that you always wanted to try to improve accuracy and hone your ability to extrapolate accuracy, because it was a difficult thing to get a hold of. You'll see why if you haven't already figured it out. In the computer, because this thing can crunch numbers so incredibly easily into so many decimal places, there's accuracy, more accuracy than you ever need. So that whole thing has fallen away. But here, you find that there's inaccuracies because of fallibility in creating the model. Then there were inaccuracies that came from the measurement. You combine those inaccuracies and you put them down on the page here, and all of a sudden, because of the abstraction, each of these things becomes something that you can look at critically in isolation from all the other parts. So, for instance, when we looked at this, at these points for this shear line here in plan view, we found that that a lot of them were lining up pretty nicely, but there were outliers. There were ones that were obviously not going to be where we want them to be. Now, at this point, it doesn't really matter whether they're because the model is wrong or because the measurement is wrong or because of the transposition of the measurement onto the paper was wrong. We're actually now designing on paper, and we're going to choose the points that we want to keep, and we're going to let go of the points we don't want to keep. And now, so that's basically, it's like, you can send a carpenter off with instructions that basically is one sentence, and then make him work for a year on it. Build me a house, okay? So basically, that little sentence of instruction is what you could then spend a month on here, and that is that you're going to take these measurements that came from here. You're going to lay them out, and then you're going to analyze each of the lines separately and reconcile them with each other, and pick what's true, you know, what you want to keep as true, and develop what you disagree with, and then at every step of the way, we can more or less deeply go into what those choices might imply towards the finished boat, and those implications are anything from visual appeal to hydrodynamic ability for whatever the purpose of the boat, or a construction constraint. There are all sorts of things that can impinge on why you decide to make a certain curve or a certain line the way it is versus something else. And basically what makes, in my opinion, what makes designing a boat such an incredible training tool for critical thinking about complex issues is that there can be such complexity on every level. I defy anyone to bring up anything that I can't, within 3 degrees of separation, bring into boats. But because of the broad possibility and implications that can be expressed in a boat, and because of how it still can be done by one individual, as opposed to having to have a whole institution, try to work up this complicated plan. It allows an individual person to grapple with and gain some sense of control and mastery over something that has broad ranging implications and many, 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 many variables and of all sorts of quality and character. So So that by being able to, at least in practice like this, in study, to start grappling with those issues and dealing with that complexity with these tools of thinking, I just think that basically applies to everything that any of you are aiming to do. And okay, so I guess this would probably be a good point for people to go ahead, do what you have been doing, and then we'll pick things up as they pop up. All right. First off, any questions? We kind of take this hour as being just sort of a push out, but there, at this point there may actually be some questions, and I'd rather take them on.
I stepped out for part of your talk, so I don't know if you covered it or not, Tony, but if you would talk a little bit about laying out the grid and what those arbitrary lines,
right,
what they mean. So if you could speak physically to the process that everybody has an idea of how to begin and where, how to think about the layout.
Yeah, well, yeah, I kind of glossed over that. Because we all now physically have a model to start with, we actually, just the way Luke's done on this model, lay out the grid on the model to start with, and I think that gives us. You have to do that anyway to make the machine work. And but also that's a great place to start getting a conceptual hold over these things. Of course, the glue lines are giving us one set of these projections. You know, the either the water lines or the buttock lines. Is everybody familiar with those basic terms? There's water line, buttock line, station. Shear? No? Okay. Let me just grab a more complicated model here. All right. I'll come back there. Okay. So these two models are done the way, you know, between these two, we've got the way all of our models are done. This is the more common method where the glue lines, the layers of wood, represent the horizontal, longitudinally horizontal cuts through the boat, which are called water lines. Now, the boat eventually is going to float on a line, you know, that's in that direction, and of course that's the water line. And then the water lines below that are called, that's called the level water line or the datum water line. The ones below that are lettered or numbered below, and the ones above are lettered or numbered above. The this model, as some of your models are done, is organized around the buttock lines. The term buttock, I think, comes from the character of the curves, especially in the stern of some of the fuller designs. You know, there's a certain roundness to the curve, but these are parallel longitudinal cuts that are perpendicular to the water lines and are parallel to the center line. You know, the backboard here is the center line, and these are parallel cuts to the center line. And as we're going to find out throughout the process of truing or reconciling the lines in on paper, each of these curves is more useful in certain parts of the shape of a particular boat than others, and will give them more weight in those areas. Now, a boat like this, which is basically flat in the waterline plane, you're not going to gain much accurate knowledge about its shape by creating some widely spaced waterline cuts through this, because as the shape, you know, as you either go into the shape or out, or as you draw the line a little bit too wide or too narrow, you can go through quite gross changes without really having changed the shape very much, because, you know, basically you're talking about crossings between your cut line and the shape of the boat, which are very oblique, right? So, you know, with an oblique crossing like this, here's the shape of the boat, and here's the waterline section, whatever. Is this point, you know, more accurate right here in the middle? Should it be there or should it be there? But when you get to a place where crossings between the shape and the cut are more perpendicular like this, well, if you're accurate, it's very obvious, and if you're inaccurate, it's very obvious, right? I mean, if anything off of that intersection becomes clear. So that in this boat, in through these shapes here, you can see that this buttock cut is very perpendicular to the shape through a lot of the bottom of the boat. It's not very perpendicular to these areas here or these areas here, but then we have the station cuts, which of course are very perpendicular to those. So this boat can pretty much be accurately gridded by a combination of buttock lines and stations. And water lines are marginally useful as far as trying to capture the shape.
On that same point, one of the things that on models, I mean, this is done with a different process, but some of the models I've made, there'll be buttock lines below the level water line and then water lines above it, right? And that's, yeah, just like part of the thinking about that is it's easier to see, it's easier to sight and judge if a long gradual curve is fair than a very tight little station curve is fair. So these, you know, the yes, sectional right. lines here can be really hard to see and judge them over the length of the hull as they move, whereas sighting that long line is an easier judgment to make.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's really important in when you're drawing these boats full size. So you'll end up having, you know, as you're drawing your boat full size, you'll draw the buttock line, say, for two-thirds of the distance of the boat. Then you won't even bother drawing the rest, where it becomes oblique up forward, and then you have a water line, so they overlap and they meet. But it's all just like reliable lines and how they, you know, how they best express the shape. But sectional lines can be, you know, if you made a card and cut out to the sectional shape of this model and laid it on it, if you tipped it 1 or 2 degrees, it would be wrong. It wouldn't quite fit correctly. So it's easier to see those longer lines sometimes.
Just trying to find how many of you have ever done, I'm sure you've all done some work where you've either in some sort of a math or math course of some sort where you've actually laid out a graph, right? And, you know, so you have a set of points and you're trying to analyze, how accurate they are, perhaps by combining them into, you know, how close they come to some mathematical ideal of some curve. And of course you pick the coordinates in a way to be as telling for that particular outcome as possible. So basically what we're doing is by attacking this complicated shape from these three basic types of cuts, we're ensuring that somewhere over this shape we're going to find a spatial and analytical tool, right? A graph that is going to be the most telling for that particular part of the curvature. And so part of what we have to do is to understand, well, over this part of the boat, if these three views aren't agreeing, which one should we give the most weight to? Which one should we say, all right, that one has to follow along and agree with what the other two say, because that one is just not accurate. So again, just to recapitulate, there's the water line cuts, there the buttock line cuts, and then the station cuts, which the guillotine here provides for us too, which are this way. Now beyond that, there's one other set of projections which are a little bit more complicated, and we may or may not get into it all over the course of this, but there are diagonal projections, where and you'll see in some of the lines plans that we look at, where you actually take And you know, from the end view, you take a series of diagonal cuts through from, you know, from like down here to up here to up here, and then, you know, those cuts are made through this way, and then you pick up on each station those intersections, and then you lay those out as projections. And those diagonals actually, although they end up being, they're considered, back in the days of paper drawing, they were considered kind of as a last proof of whether or not the rest of the design was reconciled correctly. But in the end, they're actually the closest to the actual flow lines of water across a boat's hull. You know, water isn't constrained necessarily to follow any of these geometric parallel or perpendicular cuts. It can go wherever it wants, and it turns out that basically it ends up going kind of normal, you know, or perpendicular to normal to the surface, which ends up being actually quite close to what a diagonal is. And so the diagonal ends up being a very good way of judging a boat's potential performance issues too. Although it's a fairly esoteric process until you get into CAD, where you can actually start to experiment with what those different possibilities might mean. Okay, so I think that's about it for just abstractly talking about the process. Yeah, go ahead.
This going back to some of this speaking very fundamentally, you know, about this, what you're doing on these drawings, you know, again, this how you orient that grid, but also that process of okay, you've got a line that doesn't agree here. You've drawn a fair curve for the shear line, and you have one ordinate that's outside of it. So it would mean logically you need to correct it back here, right? There's a mistake here.
Every
view is a constant. You're going back and forth and making them all agree to make the lines work. So, you know, you can't. It's very hard to judge this series of points. Do they make a fair line? Until you've done that, right? Once you have that line drawn, you see it making a nice sweet curve or not. Then you can go back and adjust. So that's just a way of cross-referencing the line.
Yeah, I was kind of saving that until we actually got into doing it. But yeah, obviously, you know, that's the whole process of reconciling on paper. On reconciling in the model was done by carving the two and getting them to agree. Here, reconciling means that you know, that this first attempt at this came from here, which came from there, and then when we make a change here, we then have to make that change back here, and then see whether or not that change affects this view also. And then that's the whole, the actual work process, and that's what we will be doing over and over again as we go along.
You know, on that note, as you're working out the shape, and that your grid is composed of arbitrary planes, and you get to put them where they have the most meaning, your diagonals and everything. So it's never, you know, because you're not working on a computer where you can have millions of stations and millions of water lines and millions of buttocks, all these different slices. You pick fewer and you choose carefully.
Right.
So
right.
You can see how Luke scheduled his station lines and.
Yeah, for instance, you know, in this boat here, there's not much point in having 10 water lines between here and here, because there are hardly going to be any different from each other, you know, because it's basically it's flat there. But it might make sense to have a lot of buttock lines, you know, through here, because the shape is changing quite quickly through that area, but to start with, basically we've got the perpendiculars, which are the extent of the hull, or sometimes they're taken from the extent of the water line, and then for analysis, for doing the measuring that leads towards figuring out what the displacement of the hull is and the different parametrics of the hull, that's done by laying out an even number of stations or that adds up to 10, I think it is, or multiples of 10, and that's a grid that although we can work with that when it's convenient, whenever necessary, we can add substations where the shape is changing rapidly and we don't feel we have control over the shape, and we don't have to start with all 10 either. We start with the extremes, the middle, and then one or more, and keep working out from there. But basically, now I'd like to do the rest of this actually working on a particular boat with people. So any kind of more general question or is there anything that just didn't make any sense, or a short list of things that didn't make any sense? Okay. All right. Well, let's just go ahead and split up and get started. So, Luke, you're gonna. Yeah. Okay. Well, here we're just quickly set this up as though there was a station at this point here, right? At this extent, and we're finding where this shear height off the or breadth off the center line would come, and Ruben,
yes.
This picks up the point. Now, where do you actually capture it on this machine?
Oh, basically, there's this will sit up here.
Oh, there
and you just have a piece of paper attached tape
oh,
on
in here,
right?
Yeah,
so you
right.
Simply, you put a book off, you put a pencil through the hole. So the way you would the way you would start this is you'd this has to be over. This is a very fussy, finicky tool, Tony. Come on. So you'd establish a centerline plane by making a mark here, right? And a mark down here. Now you have two points to define the center of the model. I think ideally this would be pointing the other way as well. So then you simply go up the model and you make a series of points. You slide it up, make another point, slide it up, make another point. Yeah, so you're poking it.
Yeah.
So you make a series of dots.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And the thing with a model to remember as you're using is that it's actually very good at taking shapes of these upper parts of the hull, because it comes in normal, it comes in very square. But as you work down the hull, it comes at a very oblique angle, and it becomes pretty inaccurate as you work down the hull. So that's just a thing to be aware of with a tool.
You could probably also use it, for instance.
Yeah, you could turn it the other way.
You could turn it this way.
Yeah, you sure could.
And get a series of them, in this direction.
Yeah, yep.
And then you put those together in your drawing.
Yeah, right. That's right. Yeah.
So.
Yeah, we haven't gone to that step ever, but it'd be nice to try one time.
But especially with a hull that is mostly in the
mostly
other direction,
front,
the way this one is.
Yep.